No, you never lost a battle. And I know, you never will. Everything's by the power of the Holy Ghost. A new wind is blowing right now, breaking my heart of stone, taking over like it's Jericho, and my walls are all crashing down, 'cause right now I know you're able, and my God, come through again.
Good morning. Praise the Lord. We trust that you are well in this season, and we believe that the Lord's hand is keeping you wherever you are this morning. We'd like to say a big good morning, and we hope that you are well, and we'd like to say karibuni sana to this morning service, as we hope that you are well this day. It's a beautiful morning. It's a time for us to praise the Lord. So wherever you are, we'd ask you to join us as we begin to worship the Lord. If you're in your bed, please just step out of your bed, take some time, hold on to your phone as we worship the Lord. If you're seated in your sitting room, stand up and join us as we worship. Being at home does not make the difference. It's good for us just to be together in the spirit, even though we are distant physically. It's good for us to join together in the spirit. I'd like us to begin by just reading from Psalm 116, from verse 12 to 17. And I'd like us to read that before we begin this time of worship. And this is what it says. What shall I return to the Lord for all the goodness, for all his goodness to me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord. I will fulfill my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his faithful servants. truly, I am your servant, Lord. I serve you just with all of my heart. You have freed me from my chains. I will sacrifice a thank offering to you and call on the name of the Lord. May we bless the name of the Lord this morning, for he is worthy of our praise now and forevermore. Amen.
Inside of me, send me to be glorified, for you to be lifted high.
Praise the Lord once more. We welcome you once more, that you would join us as we gather in the name of Jesus to worship him. So as we praise him, put down your cup of tea, whatever you're holding on to, stand up where you are, and let's just take some time to celebrate in the presence of the Lord, for he is worthy of our praise now and forevermore. Again this day, amen.
We have come to worship you, only King of Kings, Lion of Judah.
We have come to worship you, only King of Kings, Lion of Judah. Hallelujah.
Wash away.
privilege it is, oh God, that you would call us into your presence. And so this morning we join with the angels and we sing this chorus unto you, Lord. You who was and is to come. And you alone who can claim this to yourself. And so we sing it out to you this day, that you are holy, oh God, we declare.
Sing. Yeah. don't know about you, but I just want you to worship him in your own words, in your own way. We all have many tongues, but use those tongues to bless his name. They will never be enough, but in the limited knowledge that you have, bless his name for what he's done in your life. God, I worship you. I know that I'm nothing without you, God. I know that I've got nothing if I don't have you, Jesus. I thank you that you are my glory and the lifter up of my head, oh God. When I've got nothing to take pride in, Jesus, you are my glory, God, and the lifter up of my head, oh God. And so I worship you, Jesus. I worship you, oh God. I bless your name this day. I give you glory because you are good to me. And you are good to us, oh God. And because your nature is good, oh God, it doesn't matter what the circumstances are. Jesus, you are good and you are worthy of our worship. So we bless your name this day, Jesus. And we set this time apart, God, to lift you up. For we have tasted and we know that you are good and your mercies endure forever. You are worthy of our worship, God. You are worthy that we would pause in the week and just think and remember, Lord, the table that is set before us, oh God. I thank you this day that you remind us, Jesus, of the blood that was shed on the cross, Jehovah God, and your body that was broken for us, oh God. Be lifted up this day, Jehovah God, for you are good, and your mercies endure forever. And so we sing, Nara, Nara. Adoration, God, we come before you this morning, knowing that, Father God, we are in such need of you at this time, oh God. We stand right now in the gap, dear Lord, calling upon your name, Jesus, because we have no other name that we can call on to, that we would find safety, that we would find refuge, that we would find rescue, oh God. It is only in your name, Jesus. And I thank you, Lord, for your goodness towards us, oh God. And Father, we just want to make intercession right now on our behalf, for our families, for our spouses, for our children, oh God, and for our loved ones around us this day, dear God. You know the needs that we have. But God, we lift them up to you, Jesus. If there is anyone who is not feeling well among us, oh God, ask for the healing power of Jesus that was paid for at the cross to fall upon each and every one of us this morning. That God, as we gather in worship, oh God, may your presence flow even in our homes, even in our rooms. I pray for healing in the name of Jesus. Where there is need, oh God, I want to thank you that you are Jehovah Jireh, and I pray that you would make a way where there seems to be no way, and that you would provide for those who are in need, oh God. For those who are just wanting peace right now, I ask that you who is Shalom, you who is our peace, would come and reign in our homes, Jehovah God, and that, Father God, we would see your goodness and your greatness. As a country, Lord God, we're in a place where we really need you. And we just want to make intercession for our leaders who are responsible for making decisions that, God, change and direct our lives, oh God. How we pray for our leaders right now, especially our president, at this point as he has to make a decision concerning the direction of this country. We ask you, God, in the name of Jesus, that you would grant him wisdom, oh God. Surround him, dear Lord, with counselors, dear God, whose hearts are for you and for your people, oh God. I pray that, Father God, you would take away anyone who has selfish interests and motives towards this nation from his presence, and that, God, you would grant him wise counsel at this time in the name of Jesus. How we pray, dear God, for a nation, dear God, as we need to make a decision concerning our schools, concerning our churches, concerning every gathering and meeting place. We want to ask you, Lord, for wisdom at this point over our president and all the people who are advising him right now. God, we want to pray for the nation of America right now that is in such turmoil right now with just the whole racism problem, Jehovah God, and we just want to ask you, let there be peace, oh God. May you send peace and order in this nation. With the backdrop of coronavirus, I just want to pray for your peace, oh God, and that let your love shine. And I pray that even the Christians in that country would stand up for truth, would stand up for justice, would stand up for that which is right, oh God. And I pray the Lord you would restore peace and calm over this nation, oh God. We pray for the rest of the world, dear God, that is struggling in different ways, dear God, that Father, you would bring peace, and that Lord, you would bring a solution to this coronavirus, and that God, you would heal the world. How we ask you for a solution, Jehovah. And I pray that let your perfect will be done. Give us the wisdom on how to, Lord, navigate these times, oh God, in our lives. And I pray that we would be faithful to seek you and to hear your voice, oh God, during this period. We thank you for your goodness and your grace. We thank you for your mercy. We thank you for your love. May you bless us this day as we're about to listen to your word. And I pray that, Father God, we would be transformed in your presence. That we would get to know you as you really are. Be glorified and be magnified. In the name of Jesus, our Lord and Savior, we pray.
Amen.
Good morning once more. We hope and believe that you are well. And at this point, we want to say thank you so much for tuning in and joining us in our time of worship. And we hope and pray that you have been blessed and that the presence of the Lord has ministered to you this day, and that you have met with the Lord even as we have connected with him in worship. May the Lord bless you as we sit and we are about to listen to the word of God. This morning, we're going to be having our very own Reverend Dr. Patrick Murunga. He'll be bringing the word of God to us this morning. And so prepare your hearts, even as you take your seats and just prepare to listen to the word of God. Allow me to pray for him as he joins us this morning. And as you prepare to a time of giving at this point, as you prepare your phone, your wallet, I guess at this point it's the phone that works the best, that you would give and support the work of God and his ministry all over the world. So allow me to pray for you, Padre, then you can continue. Father, we thank you so much for Reverend Murunga. We thank you, Lord, for using him in just a special way in just establishing and building this church. I thank you, Lord God, for Lord Jesus using his life, dear God, over so many people's lives. He has been a blessing to this church in more ways than we can ever describe. And Father God, once more, he steps up to the podium, desiring to be your mouthpiece, desiring that you would speak through him. How I ask you, Lord, that you would honor this request, and that Father God, your hand would be upon him, that your spirit will work through him, that you would minister to us, your people, as we long to hear from you, O God, that you would build us, challenge us, rebuke us, encourage us, teach us in your ways, O God. How I pray this morning that he would be an instrument of honor in your presence, that he would be a vessel of honor to glorify you, and that Lord Jesus, he would be your mouthpiece to speak to us, and that Father God, our lives may be transformed. We thank you for him. We thank you for his life. We thank you for B and his children and their children together, O God. May you bless them, my Father God, even as he ministers to us this day. We thank you and we sit at your table and we ask you, Lord, speak, for we your servants are listening. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. The Lord bless you.
Thank you. Good morning. It is my privilege to be here this morning and just to come and share with you from God's word. Of course, you know that there's a sickness that has been declared a pandemic that is ongoing. This sickness is called coronavirus disease 2019 or COVID 2019. And as far as we know, there is no vaccine to prevent coronavirus 2019. However, the government has advised us that to prevent and to stop the spread of this disease, that we have to wash our hands. The government has told us to wear masks, to cover our faces when we cough or when we sneeze, to clean and disinfect surfaces often. The government has told us to practice social distancing and to monitor our health, that we should be alert to the symptoms. However, as Kenyans, we have decided that this is a government disease. Huu ni ugonjwa wa serikali. Serikali inatuletea drama. And yet, people are dying. I just want to say to us as Kenyans, let us get a grip. COVID-2019 is real. People are dying all over the world. Hospitals are full with people that are suffering COVID-2019. We celebrate the doctors. We celebrate the nurses. We celebrate the medical professions who are giving it their all to try and help those that are sick in hospitals to get better. And you see, anybody, any child knows that hospitals are there to help sick people get better. And therefore, the most important thing about a hospital is not the architecture of the buildings. It is not the beauty of the building. It is not even the kindness of the medical profession. It is not even the staff. It is not even the sophisticated equipment. The measure of a hospital is the ability to make the sick well, to make the sick people better. And so if a hospital doesn't do this, those that go to hospital to get treated, to get better. Those that visit hospital, go to hospital to visit those that are sick, hoping that the doctors would have helped those that are sick to feel better. Everyone that goes to hospital has the question, can you fix what is wrong with me? Brothers and sisters, the church is God's hospital. It's called to open its doors to people who are sick. People who are sick with sin. People who are sick with addictions. People who are sick with burdens. People who are hurting. They are welcome into the church of God because it's God's hospital. That means that you as a believer, you as a Christian, you as a pastor, you as a minister of the gospel, you are the physician put in charge of this sick people by the great physician who is Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And so if you come to the hospital and a physician diagnoses your disease and he says that you have this and that disease, do not get angry at the doctor if he has to take drastic measures to make you get better. Some people, even this morning, who come to the church, who come to the hospital, they have different diseases. And even this morning, they will hear their disease mentioned. They will hear the treatment prescribed. But they will not want it. You see, the church is God's hospital. The church, it's God's treatment place for you. And so if today you hear your treatment diagnosed, if today you hear, okay, if you hear your treatment diagnosed, and the medical profession, the pastor, myself, tells you that what you need to do in order to get better, please do it. If it is to quarantine, please accept it. If it is to social distance, please do it. If it's wear a mask, wear it. If it is surgery, accept it. It is true, it's a fact of life that surgery is not a pleasant thing. Surgery is not a pleasant thing. But you see, If you're going to be better, you have to go through surgery if you have a tumor, if you have a lump. You see, the goal of the physician is not to hurt. It is to treat. But many times, I don't agree with the doctor. You see a doctor with a 12-inch kishindano, and he wants to dunga you, and he says it will not hurt. Hiyo ni uongo. When you see that injection coming, you want to take off. But you see, it is for your good for you to get that medication. Because that little pain, that little time, when the treatment takes effect, you will be well. I want to call our attention to the book of 1 Corinthians chapter 5. 1 Corinthians chapter 5. My thesis, my message is actually taken from verses 1 to about verses 9, but I only want us to look at verses 1 to verse 5. And then I will, at the conclusion, I will add on maybe verse 6, 7, and 8. But our reading comes from 1 Corinthians chapter 5 and verse 1, and allow you to read that. But in this book, it's presented to us a church, the church of Corinth, a church that has a malignant tumor. And this malignant tumor, if left untreated, if left unattended to, can damage not only the individual, but the life of the church. Paul comes and says, do not tolerate this disease. Do not tolerate the tumor. Do not ignore it. Do not excuse it. Because when you excuse it, when you tolerate it, the church comes down. You suffer, and even it can kill you. And so Paul says, a common saying that you have heard of late, if you continue to behave normally, this malignancy will treat you abnormally. First of all, let us understand about the place of Paul's discussion. Look at the place of Paul's discussion. It is the city of Corinth. Corinth was a thriving city. It was at a time the chief city of Greece, both commercially and politically. Look at its commerce. When you went through Corinth, you found that through the city, there was traffic that flowed from Italy. There was traffic that flowed from Spain. There was traffic that flowed from Asia Minor through to Egypt. It was commercially thriving. It was a commercially thriving city. Its culture, it was characterized by a typical Greek culture. And the Greek culture was interested in philosophy. It was a culture that was interested in, it placed a high premium on wisdom. What about its religion? Corinth was like Kisumu or Kakamega around Christmas Day. You go to those cities, the number of little religious sects that you'll find drumming on the streets are uncountable. It was the same with Corinth. They had 12 temples in this place. One of the most infamous was the temple dedicated to one called Aphrodite, the goddess of love, whose worshippers practiced religious prostitution. In addition to these 12, there were Jewish synagogues. In addition to that, Paul had planted a church in Corinth. But like any other major commercial city, Corinth was a center of unbridled immorality. Immorality thrived in this city. The worship of Aphrodite fostered prostitution in the name of religion. So immorality prospered in this city. In fact, a name was coined for anybody who was immoral. they were Corinthianized. And that came to mean a person who was immorally not right, morally not right. And we've been talking about doctors, nurses, medical profession, hospitals and diseases, malignancies and all. And our patient this morning that I would like us to look at is the church of Corinth. And we thank the Apostle Paul because of the extensive correspondence with the Corinthians. Because through this, we are better informed of who the Corinthians were, who the Corinthian church was. This church, we are told, was a mixed congregation. Both Jews and Gentiles, and the majority of the members of this church were Gentiles, inhabited, and were members of this church. This church was not only a mixed congregation in terms of tribes, in terms of races. This was a mixed congregation in terms of class. Paul says that most of the members were socially humble, but were composed of wise, powerful, rich, and even people of noble birth. It was a mixed class congregation. Thirdly, it was a mixed gender congregation. And unlike many other churches, Paul reveals to us that in this church, women were very active. Women were allowed to participate in the ministry of this church. Women were vocal to the point that they were being told, shut up. They were praying and prophesying. Na walikuwa makelele, paka wakaanza kunyamazishwa. It was a mixed income congregation. They had members of this congregation that were privileged in terms of finances. In fact, they had people like Erastus, who was the city treasurer amongst the members of this church. In this church, like many of our churches today, you found backbiting, you found tribalism, you found discrimination, you found class division, you found litigations, and even a high level of immorality that the Apostle Paul is talking about in this chapter 5. This is the picture of the early church at Corinth. The church was sick. Now, what was the presenting problem? I call this a cancer. The cancer in Corinth. Look at it right from chapter 1. You find that there was factionalism. There was division in terms of the followership. There are those that said, oh, we follow Paul. There are those that were saying, we follow Peter. Others were saying, we follow Apollos. Others say, we follow Jesus Christ. These factions were killing the church. These factions were splitting the church. These factions were bringing division within the body of Jesus Christ that shouldn't have been there, that shouldn't have come, that should have been captured. Amongst the members in this church, there was a sense of self-importance. Some of the members in this church who had maybe the greater gifts, spiritual gifts, looked down upon those who had the lesser spiritual gifts. There was division in that regard. There was mockery of communion in the church. The Lord's Supper was affected by the division. The Lord's Supper was misunderstood in the church. But the worst of all was the immorality. The immorality that we see vividly portrayed in chapter 5. It was a strain that was worse than COVID 2019. This was a tumor of immorality. It was a tumor that was growing in the midst of the church, yet the people did not recognize it. Not only didn't the members recognize it, the leaders within the church did not recognize this disease. When you looked at the church on the outside, The church was healthy. The church looked sound. But inside, ilikuwa ni kuoza. It was rotten. It was dying within. This church that had enjoyed the greatest of preachers of all times. This church that had the best theologians of all time starting this church. This church that had eloquent preachers. Preachers that would preach until you could say get saved 20 times. It had great men. It enjoyed great leadership. Yet there was a cancer growing within this church. There was a tumor metastasizing in their midst. It was suffering a deadly illness, a deadly disease, a deadly tumor. A deadly tumor that was so destructive. A deadly tumor that was so virulent that even the pagans around the church, pagans around Corinth, avoided the Corinthians. Paul comes and says, in verse 2, it is actually reported that there is immorality among you. And an immorality of such a kind as does not exist even amongst the Gentiles, even amongst the sinners, that someone has his father's wife. Sorry, that was verse 1. Verse 2, you have become arrogant and have not even mourned. Brothers and sisters, the problem in Corinth was truly shocking. There was a man in this congregation that was living with his stepmother. It is not really his wife, it is his stepmother. And Paul says, even the pagans don't approve of what is happening. What you are allowing as a congregation to happen within the church. You see, when you look at the present tense of that verse, it means that it was an ongoing issue at that time. In other words, this man had developed a pattern of immoral living that scandalized not only the church, it scandalized the community. It was so vile, it was so sick that even the non-believers were sickened to the core. There's a boxer called Muhammad Ali. Muhammad Ali once said, I am so mean that I make medicine sick. The sin in the church of Corinth was so sinful that it made not only the sinner sick, but it made sin itself sick. You are Christians. You are believers. You have been called to represent Jesus Christ. And yet within you there's a malignancy. As believers, you have ignored it. You as a person, you have ignored that sin. You are doing nothing. Yet you know it is not right. Do you know, Christians have the capacity to act as bad as non-Christians and sometimes even worse. Though we name the name of Jesus Christ, because we still live in the flesh, we have the same propensity towards sin as the unredeemed world. Let me say this. Being converted does not exempt you from sin. It does not exempt you even from the basest of sin. If I am capable of falling into the same sins that a non-Christian commits, what is the difference between the two of us? There's a difference. The difference is that you as a believer, you don't have to. You don't have to go that direction. Why? Because the Bible says, greater is he that is in you than he that is in the world. You have somebody within you that can help you overcome that sin. What malignancy are you suffering as an individual? What malignancy are you suffering as a church? Paul proceeds to prescribe the cure. See, he says, untreated malignancy, untreated lumps have a damaging effect if they are not treated, if they are tolerated, if it is left to foster. It not only hurts the violator, but it also hurts the church. First of all, Paul says, instead of weeping in verse 2, he says, you have become arrogant and have not mourned. In other words, you are proud of your sin. You are proud of the immorality that you are involved in. You are bragging about the immorality, about the sin. And for some of us, we are saying, phew, I got away. I was not caught. For some of you, you're bragging about being part of this church. The church. But for you, as a believer, you're bringing down the church. And for us, and perhaps looking around, and I'm thinking, yeah, I know so and so. So and so has a worse disease. But he's still in the church. So and so has this other disease. I see them singing the worship team. So and serves in the ministry. It reminds me of a nursery school. I don't know if it's a nursery school rhyme. It says something. Okay, I'll create mine. You have got lambs. I've got lambs. God's children have lambs. Something like that. Eh? And so we are bragging because everybody has lambs. We think we are okay. We are not okay. We are not okay. We need to admit that there's something wrong. If the world cannot associate with us because of the sin, there has to be something wrong. There has to be something wrong. Let me ask you, do you have a lump? Do you have cancer? What sickness do you have right now that needs treatment? Are you living in immorality? Jesus is able to take care of that. Do you have anger problems? Do you have anger issues? Do you have hatred? Are you abusing alcohol? What lump is growing within your body as a believer? You see, the fact that that scandal could go on for that length of time. That scandal that was within the church, that had even come to be known outside the church, that was going on for so long. Had thrown the Corinthian church off the mark. Instead of being a witness in the community, it had become a disgrace to the name of Jesus Christ. The church of Corinth was no longer a hospital. It was a social club. Do you know, a social club is a place that you just go kujivinjari. You have a good time. There's no accountability in a social club. Let me ask you, is this the Africa Gospel Club? Or is it the Africa Gospel Church? the believers in Corinth wanted the social club kind of Christianity. They wanted to be pampered. They wanted to be petted. But they didn't want accountability. And even when they knew what they ought to have done, they didn't do it. They didn't want to go through surgery. The thing that Paul says is, get rid of the tumor. Cut it off. Cut it off. Brothers and sisters, people may come through the doors of our church with their sin, with their burdens, with their tumors, with their lumps. That is fine. But people should never come into our midst and be made to feel comfortable about the sinful practices that they are going through. They should never come to our church. They should never come to our fellowship. And we embrace them with their immorality. And brothers and sisters, when you hear a brother has been entrapped in sin, it ought to break your heart. And you ought to take action about restoring that person to fellowship, not only with yourselves, but also with the Lord Jesus Christ. You are evil if you hear that your brother is involved in some sort of sin, major sin or minor sins. And instead of helping that brother, you pick up the telephone. And all that you say is, have you heard? It ought to make you cry. It ought to make you reach out in the name of Jesus so that this person is saved, this person is redeemed from where he's at. Paul says in verse 3, for I on my part, now concerning these brothers, he's taking action. He says, though absent in body, but present in spirit, have already judged him who has so committed this, as though I were present. In the name of our Lord Jesus, when you are assembled and with you in spirit, with the power of our Lord Jesus Christ, basically saying, excommunicate him. Paul here is saying, if you are the church, act like a church. Being a church means that you are acting on behalf of Christ. Because this man's sin had gone public, his judgment needed to go public. Sin could not be overlooked. You remember Achan in the book of Joshua. What happened to him? He did not need counseling. He needed stoning, and he was stoned. We need to be a church that is able to locate cancer within the body, able to locate the lump within the body, and quickly deal with that. The church is not just a building. The church is a family. If you, as a parent, sees your child going wrong, it is your responsibility to take care of that rebelling child. You cannot ignore the rebellion, and you cannot allow the rebellion to foster within the family. This past week, Muliona Jubilee, na ODM, they decided that they did not want indiscipline in their ranks, and they cracked the whip. Whether right or wrong, but they wanted to straighten the people within their party so that they were going to follow the party line, whatever the party line was. Brothers and sisters, we have a party that is greater than ODM, a party that is greater than Jubilee. We need to take action. God has called his church to be holy. He says in his word, you shall be holy, even as I am holy. If the sin in the house, we don't need to let it go month after month, year after year, without dealing with it, because it spreads. Paul says about this church, your boasting is not good. He says, clean out. And this is paraphrased from verse 6 to 8. He says, your boasting is not good. Clean out the old. Be a new lamp. There's a story that I like in the book of Numbers. Numbers 25. Actually, Numbers 25. You can read from verse 1 and the following. But in verse 7 and 8, we find that, just a little bit background of the story, they're dealing with issues of immorality. Issues of worshiping foreign gods, just like in Corinth. And Moses says that we need to deal with this issue of immorality. And so he gives a verdict. He gives a mandate to these people that they should kill these people who are involved in immorality. And as in the midst of that discussion, in the midst of the congregation discussing that issue, a certain one, as it says, comes with this foreign woman and they head right to their tent. And in verse 8 it says, when Phinehas, the son of Eleazar, the son of Aaron the priest, saw it, he arose from the midst of the congregation and took a spear in his hand. And he went after the man of Israel into the tent and pierced both of them through, the man of Israel and the woman through the body. So the plague on the sons of Israel was checked. In other words, this man took decisive action to rid themselves of the plague that was hitting the nation. He took action. Brothers and sisters, what is it that you're going through? What is it? What lamp is growing within you? The Bible says in 1 John 1, 9, if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Jesus Christ is able. Jesus Christ can cleanse you, and Jesus Christ can make you whole. And that is my prayer for you, that you will not be a Corinthianized Christian, that you will be a Christian that is focused on Jesus Christ, a Christian that wants to live above the waters, a Christian that wants to walk with Christ and have fellowship, not only with Christ, but with other believers. May the Lord bless you as we walk this journey together. Father, in the name of Jesus, we want to thank you this morning. We thank you for your goodness. We thank you for your word that is sharper than any double-edged sword. We thank you for your word that pierces through us, through and through, so that, Father, it points out and brings out that which is not right in us. And, Father, this morning, if there's anything in our midst, if there's anything in our lives that is not pleasing to you, Father, would you help identify it? Would you put a finger on it that, Father, we would take it, and that, Lord, we would confess it, and that, Father, our relationship with you would be restored. And so we thank you this morning, and we pray that, Lord, you'd be with us, lead us, guide us. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you.